First of all, welcome everybody to this meetup specifically on ethical and trustworthy AI, and more specifically on the use case of credit approval. So welcome everybody. As I said, this is our cafe, and that's why we also brought a local beer. I hope you have your drink with you too. The idea of this meetup is actually that we're gonna try to come to like a practical implementation of how you can do a consumer credit scoring case, taking in mind ethical considerations, taking in mind trustworthy AI principles. So that's actually the overall intention. Before we actually gonna do that, we're gonna give you an introduction to the topic of ethical and trustworthy AI in general, followed by a specific introduction on ethical and trustworthy AI in finance. So that's actually to make sure that everybody is on the same page, so that we have an understanding of what is like the broader topic of today. That will bring us to our first cafe. In the first cafe, the idea is that we kind of define the business problem. So what do we mean exactly with our consumer credit case? So that's the goal of the first World Cafe. Everybody will stay within his own expertise field. So we're gonna have like separate cafes for different groups of experts. And then we will obviously make a summary of that. Next to that, after that, the first cafe, everybody will be aligned on the business case and what the objectives are. And we will actually start to dive deeper into the other phases of a typical AI credit scoring use case following the CRISP data mining process. So we will look into what are the specific things you can do or you should think of when you implement a consumer credit case in practice, taking in mind ethical and trustworthy principles. So that will take approximately 30 minutes. If you have like a lot of actions and things you want to think of, you might want to prioritize that. So that's something that is also part of World Cafe 2. And that will be followed obviously by a collective summary. And then finally, we have the wrap up. But before going to those details, let's first present the different experts amongst us. Bart, I give you the honors to present or invite to present yourself.
Okay, thank you very much. Hi everybody, so my name is Bart Bassens. I'm a professor of big data and analytics at the KU Leuven, where I'm situated right now. My primary field of expertise is credit scoring, Basel II IFRS 9, and it's an area which is, I think, currently highly affected and challenged by ethical and legal concerns, I think, many of which I will try and raise during the discussion. Yep.
Okay, then I give the floor to Brahim, who is our legal expert today.
Everybody, I'm Brahim Benichou. I'm a legal researcher at Center for IT and IP Law, Leuven, which is also part of the Knowledge Center for Data and Society, together with the VUB and University of Ghent. Besides that, I'm also of counsel at a law firm, Nota Dutil, where I work on the IT department, IT law department, and I'm co-founder of a small hobby startup, if I may say so, my privacy specialist, in which I try to sell ClickWrap privacy solutions. My focus has been the last 5 or 6 years on technology sector, in contracting and the regulatory aspects on that. So last year, of course, a lot of GDPR privacy, and the coming of AI.
Mm-hmm. And then we have amongst us Professor Caroline Poes, expert in persuasive communication. Could you introduce yourself, please?
Yes, hello, I'm Caroline Poes. I'm a professor at the Department of Communication Studies at the University of Antwerp. I teach courses in persuasive communication and also persuasive technologies. I actually have a background in advertising research, but together with how the media evolved, my research also evolved in studying more interactive media, social media, and not only advertising, but also other communication through social media, interpersonal communication. And recently, I'm also focusing on human-AI interaction, and then more specifically, how users form impressions on AI system and how that influences their trust and how they interact with such systems. And also how, for example, information that they get from the media or from other people can also influence how they trust such systems and whether they will use them or not. And things like that. So really the human part of dealing with AI.
Okay, thanks, Caroline. Unfortunately, our fourth expert cannot make it today because his wife got sick during the day, actually last night. It's not sure whether it's corona related, yes or no, but we're still gonna have the expert cafe nevertheless. He provided some input to me, so we still can go ahead with the World Cafe from an ethical perspective as well. And maybe we can ask him to give more feedback later. But yeah, I don't think he will still join during this meeting, unfortunately. Okay, then I give the floor to Martin. Martin, can you present yourself as well?
Yes. Sorry, I was... Patrick van Rentegem was just emailing me to get contact. Anita, maybe check your LinkedIn also to see if people actually have issues to join, because that's just what happened. So,
okay.
Some of them apparently are. Yep. All right. Hi, I'm Martin Kenter. I'm currently head of ethical AI research at Omina Technologies, trying to implement that in the product that we are developing at Omina Technologies. And I've been working there as a machine learning and data scientist for a couple of years already. That's it in a nutshell.
Okay, maybe before we go to the general introduction, I will present myself. So I'm Anita Prinzi, I'm the product manager and marketing manager at Omina Technologies. I have a little bit of a mixed background, both in AI as in product management, and I'm very much excited about having our first meetup. And let's hope they become more popular over time and that we have like a very interesting discussion. So I'm mostly interested in having like a good discussion today, and don't be afraid that you don't get to the solutions you would like to have. We're just gonna discuss some topics and see whether we can get to like almost like a draft of what it could mean to implement ethical and trustworthy credit scoring case in practice. Okay.
Perfect. So this part is mainly a quick introduction to ethical AI and trustworthy AI. We were not really sure of what kind of audience we would have to discuss this kind of topic. So we just wanted to give a broad overview of different concepts that might be interesting for the next discussions. to start with ethical and trustworthy AI concepts, to us, well, the adoption of AI is mainly a question of trust with the end user, to make sure that the end user are the people using both the AI, but also the people, the consumers actually of the AI decisions and the AI models are aware of the ethical consequences. So the model, for example, is unbiased and takes fair decisions, and that also it respects their values. Here we clearly insist on their values and not just everyone's values, because those values can be control dependent and it's actually quite hard to deal with. The problem, of course, in ethical AI and trustworthy AI is bias mainly, that can lead to unfair decisions. And that's basically what we want to mitigate here, and to make sure that the kind of solutions that we provide to the clients are unbiased and kind of fair. Bias usually in AI systems has two major sources. So it can either come from the data itself, it can have a lot of different forms. It can be, for example, historical bias, if your data set is biased in that way. It can also be just representation bias, it can be a measurement bias. There are a lot of different kind of forms of bias that do exist here. Of course, you cannot really cover them all. It would take at least a couple of hours to do that. But basically, any machine learning model that uses a biased data set is mainly going to be biased itself afterwards, since it can learn the pattern that already exists in the data. And if you don't do anything to actually mitigate the bias itself, garbage in is equal to garbage out usually in machine learning. So that's the thing that we need to solve. The second source of bias that can actually occur also in machine learning is coming from the model themselves. So even if the model, even if the data store itself isn't biased, the model can be a source of bias due to the pattern of the algorithm, how it behaves, how it reacts, and so on. So those are the two kinds of stuff that we can that we want to deal with to make sure that we can mitigate the sources of bias and provide a solid, robust, and trustworthy model afterwards. Focusing on ethical AI itself, here the idea is really to detect and mitigate the bias to prevent the unfair decisions. And for that, of course, there are a couple of actions that we can take during the AI workflow. So what we intend with our AI workflow is the whole pipeline from data collecting, well, actually business problem definition, data collecting, data preparation, building the model, evaluating the model, and at the end, putting it into production. Here we of course need also for ethical AI to make we need to make a distinction between the group fairness, which is basically saying that we need to treat different groups or at least protected groups similarly, and individual fairness, which is basically making sure that similar instances that only differ regarding one or several protected attributes also need to be protected. So it's not exactly the same. And those two notions actually sometimes conflict. So for example, here in the topic of credit scoring, what we want, for example, is that Caucasian and Hispanic population both have the same chances of getting a good credit. And that's basically group fairness. If you look at individual fairness, you want a specific profile. If you take exactly the same attributes but just switch between a Caucasian and Hispanic attribute, for example, that it still provides a similar result. Make sure that the model is fair regarding individuals. All right. In ethical AI, of course, and the different action steps that you can take to mitigate bias can be split into different parts. First of the pre-processing, so that's basically just adjusting the feature space so that it can be uncorrelated from the sensitive attribute. A good example for that is, for example, reweighting. So you change the label, you reweight the data sets to make sure that you kind of mitigate the bias which is present in the data set in the first place. You can also work at training time. So there it's changing the constraints of the model in the optimization process itself to try to construct an estimator which is unbiased. An example could be, for example, designing a special cost additional term in the cost function of the model that will act as a regularizer to make sure that you penalize the model when it's taking unfair decisions. So that's an example of a training time mitigation that we can that you can perform. Another step on which we can work, of course, then is the post-processing. So there, the idea is to adjust the estimator, which is going to be biased, so that the decision that it's making at the end, you try to mitigate them and make sure that, to correct for the bias at that point in time. One of the examples that we can give is the reject option classification. So usually you have a threshold at which you can say to the model, okay, I want a specific prediction to be made if I, for example, 40% certainty probability to obtain a certain class, and you can play with a threshold to mitigate the bias or to mitigate at least the decision, the classification of the model, or to mitigate the bias itself. To detect the bias, we have the different measures of unfairness. So in the last, one of the papers that we read to prepare this meetup, you had about 20 different definitions of fairness. So the measurement itself of fairness is quite a complex problem in the first place. We'll cover that a little bit later. But there, of course, using an appropriate measure of fairness, an appropriate metric to evaluate the unfairness of a prediction is really important. The example that I actually gave before for the individual fairness to estimate that is causal discrimination. So it's really taking twice the same individual, but with one specific attribute that changes. And if you change that attribute, you want to make sure that the decision does not change. If it's actually the case and you know that the model is being unfair and using a protected attribute as a discriminate for discrimination. Of course, then to build trustworthy AI, what you want is that people have well gain trust in the model that you're building. That can be in itself quite a complex question in the first place, especially when you're looking at values that have to be given. Sometimes they can be morally okay, but not legally okay, and also the opposite. So, for example, using a consumer's personal data without his consent is usually considered as morally not okay, but also legally not okay due to GDPR issues and protections. If you look at someone committing adultery, usually regarding the modern Western societies that we have, it's considered as being morally not okay, but there is no legal compliance there to actually say that it's something that should not be done. So that's really the difference between the morally okay guidelines that we have and the legally constraints that we have also on the site. So the last part that you also wanted to talk about here is the explainable AI parts, where what you want to do here is to explain and to make sure that we can verify what the machine learning model is actually doing, and to explain how and why they're making specific decisions. There are different points for which we actually also want to focus on that. First, it's to be legally compliant. GDPR actually enforces a part of the legal explanation that we need to provide. Another example can be credit scoring, also applied in the US, where you actually have to give explanation of what action can be done to change a specific decision that has been made. It's also necessary to prevent the wrong decisions, which can of course be very costly and dangerous. So if you cannot explain exactly how a model works, when it's making a wrong decision, you cannot really investigate exactly how it works and try to correct it afterwards. So it's really a necessary point for the debugging of mispredictions. It's also a good way to actually increase the adoption rates of the model by building trust with the end client, so that you can show how it works. If you know how a machine works, how it behaves, what kind of decisions it makes, and so on, it's usually easier to start trusting the system itself and to rely on the system. Finally, it's also necessary to improve the machine learning models to know how they work and how they can actually be improved by implementing a new algorithm or correcting existing algorithms to make sure that they behave correctly, and also, of course, then to learn new insights. A couple of examples on how explainable AI works. It's usually first by using more interpretable models. So, for example, shallow decision tree is quite understandable if you just have a couple of nodes that you need to work through, that even a human can actually use that tree to take decisions. You also can use, for example, post-hoc explanations methods, which are basically methods to try to explain, once the decision has been made, how that decision has been. There we make also the difference between the global interpretation, which is basically being able to explain how the model in general works, how it behaves, and what kind of specific patterns we see in the model itself, but also the local interpretation, which is basically taking one specific prediction and explaining how that prediction was made specifically for that user. Right. Finally, the last topics that we want, that we think are also part of ethical and trustworthy AI concepts, are the transparency and accountability. So it's really, transparency is important to us to really show how the AI contributes to, the lack of transparency actually contributes to AI adoption. And that's if you can just really explain how the whole solution was built, what kind of process has been put in place, where the data comes from, how the model was trained, and so on. It's actually a hinder to AI adoption. And finally, we also want to look at robust and safe and secure AI. that's well, which is always a compliance problem, of course, and could lead also to data leakage. So they're making sure that the whole pipeline that's put in place, so not only the models, but also the data collection before, and the decision-making afterwards have to be robust against adversarial attacks and hacking possibilities. So that's it mainly, well, the different topics that we wanted to cover here for ethical and AI and trustworthy AI. Anita?
Okay, thanks. So basically, given that we have like a generic introduction to the topic of ethical and trustworthy AI, I would like to look more generally or actually more specifically, what does it mean to have like ethical trustworthy AI in finance and more specifically in credit scoring? So I'm just gonna introduce some concerns that we have seen over the past, that kind of things. And then we can actually go into the actual world cafes and actually discuss the real case that we want to discuss. I think then everybody is up to speed, so we can have like a good discussion on the topic. Okay, let's get started. Can everybody see my screen? It's loading, I see.
Okay. Yes, it's working.
Okay, there we go. So basically, there are a couple of issues that we have seen actually in the past. One of the famous cases is the case of the Apple Card, where there is a wife who actually fills in the same tax returns as her husband, lives obviously in the same community property state than her husband, and they have been married for a long time. Nevertheless, when she applies for the credit card, the Apple Card, she gets a smaller credit. She gets a smaller credit line than her husband. So obviously, it's kind of strange that these persons, husband and wife, do get different credit terms depending on whether the person is a man or a woman. So this seems like very unfair. If you ask it to any person, it sounds very unfair. What is although very striking here is that it wasn't that difficult or that easy actually, sorry, it wasn't that easy to identify what was the main reason why the woman gets worse credit terms than her husband. So that makes it important that when you automate certain decisions using AI, that it's very important that you can explain the decision later, especially when something goes wrong. So in this case, going wrong was mostly resulting in an unfair situation. So Apple should be able to explain why they came to that unfair decision. Secondly, we also seen some cases of what they call societal bias. So, for example, in the United States, there's like a famous redlining situation where actually people living in worse areas also typically got only a mortgage for the worse areas. Whereas if they would apply for a mortgage in a more upscale neighborhood, they would never get actually the mortgage. So that way, it's claimed, for example, that Chicago has systematically moved certain minority groups in certain areas of the city so that they could group certain minority groups in certain regions of the city. So that's obviously not that fair to those communities. Closer to home, I would say in the UK, there's like also evidence that there is found that, for example, non-white households are less likely to have financing. So that's also very striking that even closer to home, we find those kind of societal bias. So it's obviously true that if we are working as a data scientist on, for example, a credit scoring use case, we have to be aware that sometimes in the data that we are training on, that there is already historical bias in the term, in the sense that certain decisions historically were already biased towards certain groups. Also, what is also important to realize is that the data that is given to data scientists is not always representative. So sometimes for minority groups, we don't get enough data. So the fact that, for example, females are largely underrepresented, or for example, a certain group with ethnical background is underrepresented in a certain database, might already give rise automatically to a biased system. So that's also something to be aware of, that when we train credit scoring models, there's like a risk not only coming from societal bias, but also because there's like a risk that the data is not that representative. So that's another thing to take into account. Also very important is that I read quite some papers on fairness, and basically fairness is like a cultural concept. So it's an ethical concept, it's embedded in culture, which means that the definition of fairness is actually not that fixed. Also, there's a big claim to have like contextual fairness definitions. So what it means to allocate credits in a fair way might be totally different for example, of to make it very applicable. If you have to decide these days who should be admitted to the hospital and who can get a corona test, you want to be fair there, of course, that those people that are most at risk of actually having corona would get the test, the corona test, and would be admitted to the hospital. But what it means to be fair in that situation might be totally different from what it means to be fair in a consumer credit allocation case. Also, the definition of the groups, there is like a lot of distress amongst data scientists that all papers are talking about the easy groups to test group fairness for. So we all know that we cannot discriminate on gender, we cannot discriminate on age, and so on. So you have like the typical protected groups that every data scientist is aware of that they need to check. But often there are like other groups more subtle in the data. An example that I have been reading is, for example, if you have like automatic scoring of exams at the university, obviously if English is your mother language, yes or no, will influence how you score on that test. If you include that variable in your model, there might be some bias towards people in those groups, whether they have mother language English, yes or no. So you probably should treat it as a protected variable, just like age and gender. However, you will not find any paper specifically saying that you need to treat the mother language as a protected group, for example. And that also shows you that the fairness definition and the protected groups, for example, to test group fairness, that is equally important in assessing group fairness. There are also, as Martin said, so many fairness definitions and measures that it's very hard to select the right measure. And even worse so, it's proven that there is, depending on which group fairness metric you use, you will get to different conclusions. So this is a paper by Verma and Rubin specifically to credit scoring. They have tested all these 20 different group fairness metrics. And as you can see in the last column, depending on which one they are using, they find their credit scoring system to be fair or unfair. So that proves the point of the importance of selecting the right fairness metric, given probably the business definition of what should be defined as fair in that specific use case. Also, when we look at explainable AI and lending, it seems like if you read the different laws, for example, you have in the United States, you have the Equal Credit Opportunity Act that states you have to provide like the, I think the three main reasons for taking an adverse action, which could be you deny the loan, or it could be that you changed the terms of the loan as requested. it seems like very obvious to give like the three most important reasons, but we all know that if you build like very, very complex ML models, it's not that simple. So you have to look into the specific structure and weights of your mathematical models and so on. So whereas for a human and more like layman person, it might seem like this is like an easy question. In practice, it's often not that easy. And that's why we also wanted to have this more like practical meetup to at least reflect a little bit on how can we translate some of these bigger concerns that we have seen in the past, specifically to credit scoring, how can we translate that into practical guidelines? So what can we do? What should we think of if we implement a credit scoring case, bearing in mind ethical and trustworthy principles? Also, there might be different explainable AI solutions for credit scoring. So typically, you want to have like a global explanation, which means that given all the customers that you have been scoring with regard to credit worthiness, you want to convey what are the main drivers that build up to your credit score. So this is an example of the FICO score, which is kind of one of the most important scores in credit scoring in the United States. So here you can easily see that 35% of your credit score would be relying on your payment history, 30% approximately on the amounts that you owe, and so on. They clearly state that depending on your specific situations, those percentages might vary a little bit. But in general, they say for the average customer, this is like how the different factors weigh in into the final credit score. If you want to explain to a particular individual why they got a certain credit score and why they were either granted or denied a certain loan, you could try to evaluate and show what is the impact of each of these factors into, for example, this customer's score of 723. So in the United States, people, the banks are actually putting thresholds on this score. So suppose that the threshold would be on 700, it would mean that this customer is actually granted the loan. Maybe a more conservative bank might put the threshold on 750. That would mean actually that the customer is denied the loan. And you can see these are the factors that weigh in, and they are ordered from extremely influential to least influential. This is also to give you a little bit more background of what we mean specifically with explainable AI when it comes to credit scoring. Okay. Before we actually go to the more interactive part of this session, are there any questions related to the introduction on ethical and trustworthy AI in general and the introduction more specifically in for credit scoring? Okay, in that case, I would like to move on towards the more practical part. So to make it very concrete, we decided to work with a very specific scenario. So imagine you have a customer, John, or you have a female customer, Judith, and they go to, for example, Amazon to purchase a fancy TV online. And while she is in the process of paying for the product, she is offered a loan, consumer credit loan. So it basically means that she is automatically scored by a consumer credit scoring application. Why is that possible? Because the company, in this case, for example, Amazon, has a partnership with the bank of that customer. So in that case, we can the company Amazon could actually automatically score John and Judith on their credit worth using the AI solution, and then deciding whether they should get a loan, yes or no. So this puts us a little bit in the context of automatic credit approval, e-commerce setting, and obviously consumer credits. To make it even more specific, we thought it might makes sense to provide you with an example data set. It's not that you cannot discuss outside of the data set, but it's probably more easy to think of the specific data set. So basically, what you can see here is the German credit risk data set. I think some of you might be very familiar with that data set. It's, we have chosen for a snapshot of the data set. So originally it has 20 variables. In this case, it only has 9 predictors, and the 10th is obviously the credit worthiness of the person. So basically every line in the data set is a customer for which we try to assess whether it's a good or bad credit risk. And in terms of profiling behavior, profiling variables, we have the customer's age, sex, their job, their housing. Then we have two variables on their current financial situation. So in terms of how much money they have on their savings accounts, and also how much money they have on their checking accounts. And finally, the last three variables pertain to the credits they are applying for. So the credit amount, the duration, and also what specific the purpose is of that credit they are applying for. So the objective of of the entire World Cafe is actually that we end up with something that looks like this. So if you're familiar with the CRISP data mining process, it actually tries to show you what are the different steps in a difficult in a typical data mining project or an AI project, starting from the business understanding, which would mean in this case to really understand the consumer credit use case, moving on to data understanding, where the data scientist would actually try to understand, okay, what is the data that I need to solve this business problem, what is the quality of the data, do we have a lot of missing values, all that kind of things, which leads to data preparation, where the data scientist would build some metrics, would perhaps do some transformations as well, leading to the modeling phase, where we would build the credit scoring model, taking in mind the variables that have been created there. So there's like a continuous loop here. And then after several credit scoring models have been developed, typically you will evaluate them, not only from a mathematical point of view, but also in combination with business. So that's why we also have the arrow to the business understanding. And finally, after the evaluation, typically one model is selected to be deployed. And that's actually the final solution that is then implemented and monitored. And after time, we can update that model again. What I would like us to think to do actually is actually to first define the business understanding. That's the first cafe. And then the next cafe, we will look into the different and the other phases of what we should think of or what we should do in order to implement the consumer credit use case in a more ethical and trustworthy way. But let's first start with the first business cafe. So given your expertise, so I tried to assess your expertise and allocate you to the right group as much as possible. But given that you are a legal expert, a credit scoring expert, communication expert, or an ethical expert, we have created specific key questions. And the answers to these key questions should help us to define the business understanding.